We can climb so high, I never wanna die. Just a small town girl living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going anywhere. A singer in a smoky room, a smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile they can share the night. It goes on and on and on and on.
Strangers waiting up and down the boulevard. Their shadows searching in the night. Street lights, people living just to find emotion.
Well, or that was the Fox one.
That was the Fox one.
Good evening to everyone out there listening on the airways and also that's watching on W5KUB.com out on the internet. We want to welcome you tonight to Amateur Radio Roundtable. I'm Tom Medlin, W5KUB, and with me is Martin FQ, K5FLU. Hey, Martin, how you doing?
Good, Tom. I'm glad to be here with you.
Well, you know, this is kind of unusual. You're in the studio with us tonight, and we really appreciate you being here.
Oh, well, thanks for inviting me. I had to bring my wife up to Memphis to the airports for her to go visit her sister, and Tom was good enough to invite me to his home and studio here. And I'm just so surprised that on such short notice, there's so many have logged on.
Yeah, well, hey, we always, you're always welcome here, and we're glad we got you. And, you know, I forgot this time to say what the date was, so I'm going to say today is Tuesday, November 21st, and we've got Thanksgiving coming up here. Boy, Thanksgiving is one of my special holidays. I think that's the most special holiday for me throughout the year. And we're going to be in North Carolina Thanksgiving at our home over North Carolina, but we just want the show to... continue to go on, and that's why we're on here today. Hey, it's going to be a free-for-all. We don't have any agenda for the show tonight. We're going to talk about anything and everything ham radio related. If you've got questions, put them in a chat room for Martin, and we will we'll take your questions. In fact, I'm going to also open up some phone lines here in a minute. I didn't open a phone line, but I'm going to open a phone line. So we'll have phone lines available here in just a little while, too. So, hey, you know, we're going to talk about anything and everything, and I'm just going to get it started right now. Martin, you know, I've been building and working with some antennas lately, and that's kind of one of the things that people can do now. Without spending a lot of money or having to buy radios and stuff, and it's fun building antennas and experimenting with them. So over the years, you've been a ham now 60 years almost.
Pretty close to it. Since 1960.
Yeah. So what kind of antennas did you use throughout the years?
Well, you know, all of us started off with dipoles, and but one antenna that I remember very well was on 20 meters. I had built a extended double zap, which is basically 2 5/8 waves, and you can get about 3 dB gain over a dipole antenna, and all it takes is a little bit more wire. And this was back in the real early days when I had just gotten into ham radio. You know, didn't have any money, didn't have any experience, but you know, I could read from the handbook or from some magazines. But anyway, I built that antenna using wire that came from an electromagnet from a speaker. You know, back then, we didn't have good magnets. And in order for a speaker to work, they had to build an electromagnet, which essentially was a piece of iron with a lot of wire on it. So these old radios that were built back in the 30s that I got from my radio TV repairman friend, I could unwind that wire and use it for an antenna. That was soft copper wire, so after a while it would sag and break. But making this antenna, a normal dipole antenna, is about 36 feet or so long, 33 to 36 feet long. An extended double zip was about 90 feet long. And I ran TV twin lead, 300 ohm twin lead to it, and brought it down to a home built single band antenna tuner that was tuned using a flashlight light bulb. Connected to that flashlight light bulb was a coil of wire, maybe two or three turns, that you held close to the coil in the antenna tuner. You tuned it for maximum brightness. And with that antenna, I got out all over the place. I mean, it was really a good antenna, and it didn't cost anything.
So that was simple back then. And your tuning indicator was this little bulb with a little inductor you held near your coil, and
that's right.
You tuned up until that bulb got bright.
Got
and
bright.
That was it, you know. And you're talking about those little speakers. I wish I had pulled up a picture of one. Probably a lot of people nowadays have never seen that, or they probably don't know what we're talking about, because I'm really old, so I do remember that. But, you know, back then, these old Zeniths and different radios, boy, they had these speakers, you know, about this big around in there. And they had like Martin was saying, they had a big coil on the center where the magnet normally is. They had a big coil there and a piece of iron. And that's what gave the speaker the magnetic properties to work. And that coil also used to have a second function as the choke coil in the power supply. But I used to tear transformers up and coils like that to get wire mm-hmm. out of. And growing up, I don't think I ever had a shortage of wire.
Yeah, no, we had plenty of wire. And, you know, like you were saying earlier, you know, if that speaker went bad, what in later days what they usually did was to replace the speaker with a permanent magnet, but left the coil there because it was part of the power supply for
right.
filtering.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, boy, I miss those old radios. I had an old Zenith, boy. Zenith, you know, with the round dial, had the I-tube in it, AM, shortwave. They didn't know what FM was then.
Well, you know, I remember we had an old Philco radio, and you had to have an antenna on it, so you would sit there in front of it, you would hold the antenna, and you were the antenna.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Sit there and listen to programs like The Long Ranger and Hopalong Cassidy. I mean, it was like watching television. You just sit in front of it and listen to the programs.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was the excitement back then. Everybody would get around the radio. And, you know, I saw an article the other day I was reading about. Back then, people had rather give away their refrigerator or some other household thing and keep the radio, because that was a central focal point, you know, of the house here. So, you know, hey, that's cool, building antennas, and again, that's fun. Well, you know, what about operating, Martin? How much operating did you do? Are you active now on the ham bands much? Or
well,
tell
not
us about that.
All that much, but I do get on CW on 40, 20 meters, and was fairly active mobile because I was driving between Starkville, Mississippi, and Atlanta to see our two grandkids. I've got a 3-year-old granddaughter and a 7-month-old grandson, and it's about a 5-hour drive, mm-hmm. and I can use my mobile and just, you know, pass the time away and have a good time talking to people on 20 and 40 meters.
What kind of radio you run mobile?
Well, you know, I've got lots of radio. This was a radio I bought off of eBay, and I was using a TS-50. It's a really old radio.
Yeah, TS-50.
But it's really simple to use, and this is great for mobile. You only have to push a button or two, and you don't have to go through a bunch of menus.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Radios have become really complicated. You know, I think I'm just getting too old and too tired to try to work all the menus and stuff on them.
Yeah. Well, especially driving, it makes it pretty hard.
You know, back in the day when you just had knobs to turn buttons to push it was a lot simpler, wasn't it?
Well, just like the new cars now, you know, the old cars, you push a button and it did one thing. Now you have to go through a menu just to turn something on.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about there.
But usually when I operate at home, it's usually on CW. Once in a while, I will get on sideband, but not very often.
Well, you know, we were talking a little about antennas, and now we get mobile. But let me jump back to antennas. Martin, you know, some of us are experimenting, and we're building our own cobweb. And that's a neat little antenna. And if you've been following us on Facebook, guys, you see that we're I've got the matching, circuit. It's two toroids and some coax that supposed to give us a 12.5 to 50 ohm match. So that'll be going in next, and we'll be reporting on that on the show. And you know, Martin, I was looking at this. This is that little RG316 coax, and I looked the specs up on this. I can't believe it. The specs say at 10 megahertz, this stuff is good for 2,000. It's good for 1,800 watts.
Well.
It's silver plated and some kind of Teflon, and you know,
I think that's the key to it. It's a Teflon.
And then you know, up as high as 30 megahertz, it's good for just a little under a kilowatt. So,
wow.
That's just hard for me to believe that it's a you know. Mm-hmm. Now they make it. What is it? RG174.
174. Yeah.
It's about the same size, mm-hmm. but he, you know, in the plans, he specifies not to use more than 100 watts on that. Mm-hmm. If you want high power, to use the RG213. Now, again, that looks awful small to me, but I guess the Teflon's the key.
Well, it is the key for the power handling of coax. But let me mention why you want to use this transformer. You know, a cobweb is really a full-size dipole that's bent into a square. And anytime you reduce the overall length of it, the impedance drops. And in this case, it goes from 50 ohms down to about 12.5 ohms. So you have to get it back up to 50 ohms, and that's why Tom has that transformer in it.
Well, we're going to see how this works. Now, Martin, tell us, how can I test this with one of the antenna analyzers? If I want to see if this gives me that true 4-to-1, what can I do? You know, I got a 12.5 ohm side, and I got a 50 ohm side.
Okay. Well, on a 12.5 ohm side, just connect the 12.5 ohm resistor there, and then connect on the 50 ohm side the SWR analyzer. And if it's 1-to-1, you know that 12.5 ohm has been transformed up to 50 ohms. And you can also sweep it across a wide frequency range and see where it stays.
Okay.
SWR 1-to-1.
I hadn't thought about that, but that should give me an indication for how broadband this is. Of mm-hmm. course, the plan here is to get this down to 20 meters at least, right? To 14 megahertz and up to about 30.
Oh yeah.
We'll see how that goes.
It should easily cover 20 meters up through 10 meters.
So, you know, I'm going to say, well, Martin, I mean, I've got probably 1,000 resistors, but I probably don't have a 12.5 ohm resistor. So why can't I take a pot, maybe a 10-turn pot or something? I guess I probably should use a carbon resistor, not a wire wound, right?
Yeah.
So couldn't I take a pot and just set it with the ohm meter for 12.5 ohms?
You can.
And connect that across there?
You can. The only thing you have to watch for is if the pot has too much capacitance or too much inductance, and you can also take 4 50-ohm resistors and put them in parallel and get 12.5 ohms.
I could, yeah. That's, and you know, on a previous show, you talked about when you were building stuff back as a kid and you didn't have a resistor, how you would take a file, like a triangle-shaped file, you would cut through that resistor change it.
That worked really good. Those were back in the days of carbon composition resistors, and you could, like Tom is saying, just take a file and just file down the middle of it and increase that resistance to whatever you want. You know, I used to put an ohm meter across the resistor, mm-hmm. and just kept filing it until I got exactly the value that I wanted.
Well, you know, in my days of building, and so I never really thought about that, or I never did that. I always found a combination of resistors that, of course, would put me near that value. And you know, Martin, even today in building things, I've noticed things have such a wide tolerance today. If you build little circuits, you know, if it calls for, a 270 ohm resistor, I bet you put a 350 in there or a 150 in there, and the circuit probably still work.
Yeah, probably would.
So it's a, but it, that's a kind of an interesting point where you would actually modify the resistor by filing into it and changing the resistance there.
Well, the other thing we did like that was dis-ceramic capacitors. You know, you could take one like a 0.01 and break it in half, and you would have a 0.005 microfarad capacitor.
Uh-huh. Now, I never did capacitors like that, I understand it. That's cool. Yeah. I'm going to put the phone number up there. We'll just go ahead and put the phone number up if anybody does want to call. Phone number is on the screen there, and we'll take some calls here. Looks like KO6PS just joined us. I don't know if he's in, you can't tell nowadays where a 6 is. He might be in Memphis. You just can't tell.
No, back in the old days, whatever call district we're in, your call could, you could tell where he was, but no more.
And back then, too, I mean, back in early years, I don't know what year they changed it. If you moved from one region to the other, you had to change your call, I think, to that region. And you don't do that anymore. So you keep your call and you move anywhere. Well, hey, guys, if anybody wants to call us, 901-286-1116, and we'll be glad to let you in here if you've got a question or just want to talk about ham radio. We like talking about the old-time stuff, man, We like talking about 40 years ago, 50 years ago. Yeah. It was a lot different back then.
It's pretty incredible what radios can do nowadays.
It's incredible that we were able to make contacts back then, to tell you the truth,
One thing I want to do is my original receiver that I had, I must have been in the 7th grade, 8th grade, was a Night Kit Space Spanner regenerative receiver, and I still have it, and I want to and I tried back then to make contacts using that, but I never could make contacts because when I went from transmit to receive, the frequency would change and you couldn't hear the guy anymore. But I want to put that thing back on the air and use some low power and see if I can make a contact with a regenerative receiver.
Well, they used to do it many years ago. Who's on the phone?
Hey, Tom, this is Bill, WZ1L.
Hey, Bill.
Hey, Bill.
How you
doing,
man?
I have a question from Martin. This all-band 80 to 10 meter NFED half-wave antenna that you sell there. I have a question in regards to the grounding of that. My shack is located on the second floor of my home. And I realized that, the closer to the ground your station is, the better grounding potential you have. Would I have to put more than one ground rod for that, or would I just use a single one?
Well, I think you would be fine with not much of a ground at all.
What's that antenna?
Half-wave NFED. And because it's a half-wave NFED, what that means is the impedance feed point is a really high impedance. So it doesn't take much of a ground for that antenna to work. And you're right, it covers all those frequencies just from feeding it from the end.
Like you don't have to have just a great ground system for that antenna. It should probably still work.
Uh-huh. Well, I was just curious, if I was going to run into problems. And I see that it's 132 feet. I could probably get one leg up to the top of a tree, and then the other one would go off at a 45 degree angle from it. So, I mean, you know, I was just curious.
Well, this is a single wire, right? This is an end fed.
Right.
You're talking about bending. I think he's talking about bending it for legs.
Yeah, you can do that. Yeah. Just drape it over a tree limb. And but, yeah, it's only one end that you feed.
Yeah, so it should work okay, Bill. Hey, looks like we've got...
I thank you for taking the call, and I hope more people call in.
Yeah, well, thanks, Bill. You're welcome. Looks like we've got...
nice to see you again there, Martin, and take care.
Okay, thanks for calling, Bill.
We've got it looks like Spain has joined us. I think it's, it may not be, EA3HSO. Yeah. It's somewhere near Spain.
I think so.
Has joined us. We'll say hello to you. Do you know any Spanish?
No, I haven't hard enough time talking redneck English.
Well, you know, but we're both from the South. We can understand each other here, you know. So, ¿cómo está usted? I'll start it off with a little Spanish there. All right, that's to EA3HSO. You're watching Amateur Radio Roundtable. And we're coming to you from Collierville, Tennessee tonight. And we've got Martin F.G., the founder and president of MFJ, with us tonight. If you got any questions, send them in a chat room or call the phone number.
Okay,
using Barcelona.
Yeah, I see that. That's good.
You Barcelona.
Know, one of our engineers is from Spain. I think he's from Barcelona, maybe Madrid. I can't remember now.
All right. Hey, look here. We've got an extra last week.
Wow.
That's KG5TLT, Jim. Got his extra last week. That's great.
Ah, great.
Yeah. You know, Martin, we started with our general license. We had the whole band, didn't we?
Well, we did, but...
in the 70s, they started taking it away.
Parts of it. That's right. Well, actually, when I started, I was a novice.
Okay. Yeah.
So we were limited
Yeah. But, I mean, once we got that general, we had all the privileges in all the ham bands.
Well, you know, they had something that was the predecessor of the VE, which was called the conditional class, which was a general class, but it was given by some volunteer hams back then.
And I think, wasn't the requirements you had to be like 150 miles or something away from a testing place?
Yeah, that's right. You couldn't, you know, it was a problem getting to the FCC office, so if you were far enough, you could get the conditional class, which is what I did. We had to go to New Orleans from Hollandale, Mississippi, and that was real hardship.
Yeah. John's saying, thank you, Martin, for adding the 30 and 40 meter add-on kit to the cobweb and making the parts individually ordered there. We got Santa Rosa, California ordered us, joined us.
Oh.
And hello, Spike, W4AAX. Not sure where you are, but we're talking with Martin here tonight. And hey, no agenda tonight. We're going to talk about everything. Boy, we've been talking about antennas and radios. And
let me mention one thing. You know, I guess it's John, KC7DRI. But, you know, any of the parts, if you want to build your own cobweb antenna, they're available from us, the fiberglass tubing, the transformer, the wire, the insulators, any of those you can order from us individually. And I also want to mention that we're going to build a cobweb antenna that's much stronger, that will include the 30 and 40 meter band as part of the antenna. Now the one that we have now goes from 20 through 10 meters, and you can get 30 and 40 as an add-on kit.
Well, once I get mine working, I'm gonna think about extending it and putting that 40 on here, but that's gonna make it a little bit larger.
It's gonna make it pretty good bit larger.
Yeah.
But we're also going to bring out a two element hex beam that will cover 20 through 6 meters, and then based on the frame of the cobweb that includes 30 and 40 meters, we're going to bring out a hex beam with three elements.
Well, Martin, the cobweb you have today, it goes down to up to 10 meters. Would it be any problem putting 6 meters on there?
No, I don't think there'd be any problems.
I mean, should it that. Just, if you just put that 6 meter piece of wire on there, should it kind of fall in place? No special anything?
Well, it should work fine. The only thing you have to worry about is the transformer working at six.
Oh, at that frequency. Yeah, I got you. Okay. Yeah, because that is stretching it from 30 on up to 50 there. Who we got on the phone?
Hi, this is Joe, KO6PS here in California.
KO6PS. Hey, Joe. How you doing, man? Out in California.
Yeah, Joe. Glad to hear you.
Well, Joe, how'd you find us and know we were on right now? This is not our, well, I'll just ask how you know we're on.
Well, I saw you post the number on the, while I was viewing the broadcast.
Yeah, okay, good, cool.
And so I was just calling to tell you that I've really been enjoying the last several shows about antennas. And I also wanted to tell Martin that I picked up the MFJ9200, the little QRP radio with all the six-band modules last week. And I've been just having a lot of fun with it. I've already worked off of just the wire. I've worked Canada, Japan, Mexico, Hawaii, and Australia, and a handful of ops here in the United States also.
Oh, wow. Well, that's great. Isn't it fun to be able to work those stations with such low power and such a simple antenna? I mean, that's real ham radio.
It's just really a lot of fun. Yeah. It's amazing what you can do with five watts, especially with the band conditions of the solar cycle being at a low. And also, I've been just really enjoying all the information about how to make antennas resonant. And I thoroughly want to thank you for coming on the show and sharing your wealth of information. I've been a ham since the early 70s. But yeah, I never stop learning. There's always more to learn, and I really appreciate everything that you've been sharing.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you saying that, and you're right. Ham radio is a learning hobby, and you know that's one of the parts of it that I enjoyed most. And I appreciate you calling in to here, and we still have some of those 9200. Transceivers with all the band modules, if anyone is interested in those. I think you asked me in an email, Tom.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, Joe, great to hear from you. Glad you joined us.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Thanks for getting me on the air. You guys keep up the good work. I'm going to go flip back over to where I can watch at the same time.
Okay.
73.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
All right, that was Joe, KO6PS in California, calling in. Mm-hmm. Hey, Martin, someone's asking, you know, you've got all kinds of, you know, people live in all kinds of different homes and restrictions, and here's a guy here that's, he's in a, let's see what he says he's in. He's in a motorhome.
Okay.
And he bought a lot in New Mexico, and he's not permitted to put a wire antenna up on the lot.
Mm.
So he's wondering, you know, he's mentioning like a Hustler 6BTV. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what the 6BTV is. Is that a mobile antenna or just a vertical antenna?
I think it's a vertical antenna that has to be worked against ground. But we have several antennas that will work for your situation. Now, we have some that doesn't require any grounds. I think you ought to take a look at that cobweb antenna. That would be almost ideal for you.
And he could put that cobweb on top of the motorhome, I guess. It surely wouldn't extend past it. Let's see, that cobweb's going to be about...
It's about 8 feet.
Eight
on
feet
the side.
On the side, yeah. So that should fit...
Yeah.
Won't even hang over.
Yeah, no, I think that would be an ideal antenna for you. Now, we also have loop antennas that will work well, but I think you ought to take a look at that cobweb.
Yeah, Martin, I'm still not convinced about these loops, these magnetic loops. And I just don't see how something that small can work. And someday you're going to have to tell me and show me how something that small can generate a signal.
Oh, I would do that. They truly do work, and I have study those for the last 25 years, and they're based in science, and they truly do work. Wow. But we'll make a topic out of it sometime.
Well, I guess so, but one thing about that loop is, isn't it fairly narrow band?
Well, once you tune it, and if you don't retune it, it's narrow, but it's actually a very broadband antenna in that you can tune it throughout. In fact, the one that we have covers 10 through 30 megahertz continuously. Now, the thing about a loop antenna is if you don't build those properly, they don't work at all. And most mm-hmm. of the loops that you see that are being sold just barely work, because the loop has got very, very low radiation resistance. In fact, the one that we have uses an aluminum tubing that's 1.05 inches in diameter, and the radiation resistance of that loop, which is 30 inches in diameter, it's about 50 milliohms. So every connection wow. has to be welded or soldered, cannot be any kind of rotating contacts. But if you do that, they work really good. On 20 meters, our 30-inch loop has an efficiency of 62%. Now, what that means is if you put 100 watts into your antenna, 62 watts is being radiated. Now, that's less than a half an S unit difference. On the receive side, you can't tell the difference between that and a full-size dipole, which is about a 98% efficient. But a full-size dipole would be about 33 feet compared to 30 inches for the loop.
Well, I tell you, I've been electronics all my life and member of the IEEE and engineer, and I never really worked much with milliohms. I didn't, just never heard milliohms used that much.
Yeah.
But we're getting in ham radio now. We're getting into the milliohms, guys. What's the impedance of that antenna?
Well, once it's transformed, it's 50 ohms, but the actual radiation resistance, the part of the antenna that does the radiating, is only 50 milliohms. 50 milliohms is 0.05 ohms.
Wow.
That's pretty small.
I guess there's some critical stuff going on to match that. We think 12 and a half ohms in a cobweb is bad.
Yeah.
You're practically matching a direct short.
Well, you are, but the matching technique that we use is pretty much lossless. It's mm-hmm. it's basically a transformer. We have a small loop that couples into the big loop. So the losses isn't in the matching network. It's in the actual resistance of the components.
Yeah.
The loss resistance of the components.
Yeah. Our friend in Barcelona there says he's a happy user of the MFJ noise canceler.
Oh, wow.
Solved his electrical QRM on 17 and 15. So
Well, that's great. I appreciate you using it. Let me just talk about that for a minute. The noise canceler that we have, what it does is it uses your actual antenna, your transmit and receive antenna, and then there's another smaller antenna that you use to pick up the noise that's causing you problems. And what we do is to combine those two signals together at RF level and then adjust the amplitude and the phase of the noise signal until just the noise gets canceled out. And it really does work, and it works very well.
Well, that's great. I know some people have really, really hard problems with noise. They just can't operate with it, and it sounds like our friend in Barcelona is by this device has made two of his bands operational here, so that's great.
Yeah, no, it's great if you have a noise source and it tunes it out. I see a comment here about most loops are being for receive only. It's much easier to make a loop for receive. If you make a loop for transmit, it's much, much more difficult to make it work properly, and that's because of the low radiation resistance. I mean, every connection has to be welded or soldered. There cannot be any rotating contacts like on a capacitor. If you look at our capacitor, that the variable capacitor has no rotating contacts at all, and it's almost as good as a vacuum variable capacitor.
And I noticed that all your loop antennas, everything's welded, even the, all the plates and the capacitors and the loop, everything is welded.
Well, it is.
And you got to do that for that.
It is. Everything is welded, and we're the only one that builds a loop like that. And we weld every connection.
Well, that's cool. I see. You know, Martin, as you go down lower in frequency, it seems like you pick up a lot more noise. What do you think about this new 630-meter band?
Well,
you know, we've got a new band coming out now. And I mean, you guys have any products for 630 meters now?
Well, yeah. We're going to add those bands to our antenna analyzer. And we've gotten some comments about the Maritime ALS 500. They're using those on the new 630-meter band.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, the antenna analyzer would be very important on this band because your ground losses and mm-hmm. all that stuff. And our friend John Langridge, who had experimental license for this band, you know, he had to give the FCC a lot of information about ground loss, impedance, and different things. And I think they were using some equipment, maybe even one of the MFJ analyzers that they had modded. They'd put mm-hmm. a mod in to make it go down to that frequency. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important if we're going to start working these bands that people have equipment that will see that. And mm-hmm. it shouldn't be too hard for you to bring those analyzers down.
No, it isn't. You know, the MFJ 259 and 269 has got two band switches on it, and both of them are six position, and we're only using four positions on one of the band switches, so we can very easily add that to it. In fact, if you have one, you can add it onto it yourself.
Mm, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there are a few little kits out to get you on 630 meters now, a transmitter. I think for probably under a couple hundred bucks, you might can get some type of transmitter. I'm not sure what it is. Some of the ham radios will tune down mm-hmm. that, you know, your transceivers will tune down to the 470 kilohertz.
Mm-hmm.
Not sure how good the receiver is, but...
Well, you know, the big problem is going to be the antenna.
Yeah.
That's, but, you know, that's down just below the broadcast band, and there's been lots of experience in those frequency ranges, but it's going to be a pretty exciting band for us as hams.
Well, we've already seen people talking from California to Hawaii on that band.
That's pretty incredible.
Yeah, and you know, that's the 472 kilohertz band, but the 2200 is also approved now, 137 kilohertz. That's getting on down there.
Yeah, it is getting on down. That's going to be a real challenge, but that's what ham radio is about. It's about being challenged.
So you know, a lot of things that came around in radio were experiments that ham radio operators...
Oh, hams brought a lot of technology into radio.
Well, I guess, you know, I guess you could consider Marconi and mm-hmm. people like that a ham, right? They brought radio to us, right?
That's right. Right.
And from radio came TV.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was simple. Just throw a picture on top of it and you know, now you got a radio with pictures.
So. Yeah. Yeah.
So a lot of things have come around from ham radio and... probably a lot of this digital stuff. I couldn't even tell you. I need to research it someday and just think of all the things that ham radio has brought.
Well, you know, back in the very early days of satellite, the Sputnik, you know, there were a lot of hams that picked up Sputnik.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. So, Martin, what kind of, when you got your license about what age? 14, 15,
16 years old.
That's
when
I got mine, 16. So what kind of projects did you build growing up? You obviously built stuff.
Well, yeah, just out of old radio parts from the radio T TV repairman, and I had been interested in that much earlier, but I didn't know any hams. And I finally discovered the A Ham in Hollandale, Mississippi, where I grew up, when I had built a crystal radio. And late one evening during a summer when it was really hot, just laying in bed listening to my crystal radio, I heard somebody break in and started talking. And of course, you know, a crystal radio,
it wasn't very selective, was it?
It wasn't very selective. He was on 75 meters AM. I could hear him very clearly. And I finally discovered who he was and just went over and visited him. And if it had been earlier, I would have gotten a ham license earlier, but that was the only way that I found out about ham radio.
But, so that was your crystal. You built a crystal radio, but I think you told me the first crystal you built didn't work.
Well, right? It didn't. The first one I built was called a Foxo crystal radio, which were built during World War II. And the crystal detector was a rusty razor blade with a piece of pencil lead, and you moved it around until you could hear a signal. But being in Cub Scouts and being at age 8, you know, you didn't know you had to have an antenna big enough to pick up a signal. But the one that I built when I listened, was hearing that ham in Hollandale, was actually a crystal radio with a transistor as an audio amplifier.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, okay, now you tuned that by moving the little pencil lid, I guess, right?
Well,
or that was the Foxhole one.
That was the Foxhole one. This transistor radio used a crystal diode, a 1N34 crystal detector.
Okay.
So you didn't have to move it around.
And I guess you had a little slider on a little coil you wound or something?
Well, I think this one...
Or did it have a capacitor?
It had a capacitor
okay.
on it, yeah. One of those plastic ones.
Well, you know, hey, if somebody wants to build one, that's a simple radio to build. Now, I don't have it about four parts in it, does
yeah,
it?
Yeah, that's right.
And you know?
I think the earphone, I can't remember if it was a crystal earphone or it was one of the magnetic earphones. In fact, I found that radio on eBay. So I now have a copy of that radio.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. We just had Glenn Popel join us, KW5GP, the author of Arduino for Ham Radio, several ARL books, and also Mesh Networks. And
hello, Glenn. Glad to see you here. And we meet again, but this time... through Tom instead of at Costco here in Memphis.
Ah, all right. So, okay, so you built some crystal sets, but knowing you advanced past that. You built some other stuff.
Well, I remember building a transmitter using back then we had AC-DC five-tube radio. They were called the All-American five-tube radio. And the filaments, all those tubes were put in series, so it didn't have a transformer. And I remember building a transmitter with the audio output tube, a 50C5. And I think there was a 6C4 that was used as a crystal oscillator. And I think that might have been a 6AQ5. This was a different, but it's still the same type of tube. And audio output tube, it puts maybe a watt of audio out. But I remember driving that thing to 22 watts of input power, and the plate would turn red when you keyed it down.
That's a lot of power. A little tube about the size of your thumb right there, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, man. Well, man, I remember those radios well. All I'm starting to forget, but those AC-DC sets, like Martin said, all the filaments were in series and hooked across 110 volts, and the audio output was a 50C5, and the rectifier was a 35W4, and I forget the other three. They were 12-somethings.
Let's see.
12AT6, maybe, or something like that.
Shoot, I can't remember now.
I can't remember the 12 ones.
Well, there was a mixer oscillator.
Uh-huh.
6BE6, 12BE6,
and
12BA6.
Yeah. So guys, if you take those five tubes, and the first number on a tube there designated the filament voltage. 50C5 is 50 volts, 35W4 is 35 volts. So you start adding all those up, 50, 35, 12, 12, and 12. And I think that came out somewhere around 110 or 115 volts. And you just, man, no transformer. You just put 115 volts across there. And, you know, hey, one tube go out, all tubes go out, yeah. You know. So.
And you had to be careful in how you plugged it into the wall. You know, you would only plug it in wrong one time if you ever touched it.
Well, you know, but you know the thing about most of those back then were in plastic cases something like that.
That's true.
I tell you, you ever take the knob off and touch that shaft that knob was on, that'll get you. I remember that. But you know, there's been a lot of safety improvements, I guess, for the better. You know, the three prong plug, the you know, with the ground in it, and of course, I'm trying to think. Was our plug polarized before the ground hole was put in there? In other words, I know one slot's bigger than the other, or did that come about the same time the ground came?
I don't think they were polarized even back then.
Well, no, back then, because you could put that plug in either way.
Yeah.
And as Martin was saying, if you stick that plug in, turn it over the wrong way, that chassis has 110 volts on it, and that was pretty bad to get your hand on that and against something else.
Well,
I've made sparks before, you know, plug stuff in.
Yeah. Well, I remember the first time I learned about that was up in the attic of the store, grocery store, where I had my radio transmitter. It was a home-built transmitter, and I touched the wrong point on the radio, and it just threw me back. But that only happened once.
You know, Martin, I used to do crazy things, a teenager, experiment with stuff. And, you know, in my little town, we had, you know, the water system. It was all metal pipe. And we had gas that came into a metal pipe. Another kid and I, we played around experimenting one day. He had a house three or four houses down. And we tied a speaker to his gas pipe and his water pipe. And then I took the output of my radio and put it on a gas pipe and a water pipe. And even though both of them are grounded, he could actually hear the music coming out down his house. So we were communicating through gas and water pipes.
Huh. Isn't that something?
Oh, man. Now, there was even a little hack back many years ago with those radios. And I don't remember, I think you can look it up on the internet today, but you could actually make some wiring changes in one of those 5G radios and actually turn it into a transmitter, into an AM transmitter.
Well, I missed that. Say that again.
There was a little hack that was back then where you could take one of those AC/DC radios and make a couple of wiring changes and make it into a broadcast transmitter. Mm-hmm. And we put our own radio station on, you know, using that.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got you must have got up to bigger and better things, bigger transmitters. Now, transmitters were easy to build back then, much easier than a receiver, you know.
Well, I built several things. You know, this was, you know, we had work in the store a lot, you know, didn't have a lot of time.
Yeah. Well, Glenn Popel mentions there, polarized doesn't always matter. He had a house built and he had the wires reversed in his house. So that would be bad, you know. You need to get an inspector to check that or buy you one of those little plugs you stick in it, you know, test the wiring there. You know, back then, we were, a lot of stuff we got was old military junk. But it was good for parts.
Oh, it was. You know, that wasn't very long after World War II, and the market was flooded. There used to be a company, I think they were in Kansas City, called BA, Bernstein Appleby. They sold lots of war World War II surplus equipment, and you could buy the 12-volt equivalent of the 807 tube for like 25 cents a piece. And, you know, there were a lot of transmitters based on the 807s.
Yeah. The 807 was that a 6-volt tube? The 1625 was
the 12-volt version.
12-volt, yeah.
I think that's right.
Yeah. And, you know, the 807? Yeah, the 807 tube was very popular back then. In fact, Ham started calling beer 807, right?
That's right.
Give me an 807. Beer became the term for an 807 back then. Well, I built a few things with some 807s or 1625s, but I kind of got more into the 6146 tubes, you know, and that's kind of where I built some of my transmitters back then. They probably ran a little bit more power, had a little bit more plate dissipation, I guess. So, Martin, you've been a ham a long time like me. And we were talking earlier, things like DXCC and worked all states. You know, I don't have a single certificate. I've been a ham 54 years. I don't have a worked all state certificate. I don't have DXCC, although I probably have worked all those countries. What about you?
Well, I'm the same way. My interest was more in the equipment and just playing with antennas rather than operating. You know, I like the operating part of it, but that wasn't my main interest. So, just like you, I don't have any certificates either.
Yeah, well, I work them and I get satisfaction from, you know, putting them in a log and just never did send it off and get the and get any of the certificates there. Okay, let's see. We'll probably close this down in just a minute here. Let's see if we got any more questions from the chat room there or the phone if you want to call in. 901-286-1116. And we're talking with Martin Jew today and about everything. The old days, antennas, tubes, everything. So, let me see. Now, Martin, you're gonna have to join our Facebook group. I'm gonna get you signed up on that.
Okay.
You're not doing a lot of Facebook stuff, but we really appreciate you coming on a show like this, being part of our show, and helping to answer questions. Hey, you know, one of the things I had on my notes I forgot to mention, I was looking at a video the other day, this LDMOS transistors are coming out now, high power transistors. One transistor can run 1.5 kilowatts or more. And I was seeing a demonstration of that LDMOS transistor. And they would tune up, and they would take the dummy load off and put full power into nothing. It was open. And then the guy took a screwdriver, and he was shorting out the coax connector. And, boy, it was making some sparks there. And it never, ever blew that transistor. And I hear you guys are working on something that yeah. will take similar to that. I mean, and we're talking about SWRs of 65 to 1.
Yeah, yeah. No, we do. We have an amplifier that's been in use for, I don't know, last 5 or 6 months for 2 meters that uses the new version of that LDMOS transistor that was in that video. But we're going to bring out a whole line using those type of transistors, all the way from HF through VHF and UHF.
Well, that's one of the things I've always worried about was the solid state. And, you know, me being a tube guy and an old ham, I know a tube could probably handle more issues maybe than a transistor. And transistors are getting better. You know, used to. Boy, you could blow a transistor out in almost, you know, easy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I remember when I was a kid buying these transistors. The first one that was widely available to hobbyists was the Raytheon CK722. And you know, you look at those things wrong, they would burn out on you. I mean, they're very, very fragile, but mm-hmm. it's come a long way since then. There were two transistors that were real popular, the GE version, which was the 2N107, and then that, and the Raytheon one, which was the first ones, they were rejects. CK722, there's lots of us grew up on those transistors.
Oh, yeah. Well, hey, I think we had a pretty good talk. We talked about a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it, and we had some good questions that came in the chat room and a couple of callers. Guys, I want to thank everybody out there for tuning in tonight. We've shows just run about an hour. Before I do get off here, let me just take a quick break here.
Contest season is here. ICOM's high-performance and innovative transceivers will help you make the most out of the contest season. Continue your contesting momentum with the IC7300. Ideal for the ham on the go, it's a high-performance HF transceiver with a compact design. It has RF direct sampling, 15 discrete bandpass filters, a large 4.3-inch color touchscreen, real-time spectrum scope, and an SD memory card slot. The IC7851 will give you the competitive edge you've been looking for. Raise the bar and hear what others cannot hear with this HF through 50 MHz transceiver. Features include reciprocal mixing dynamic range, a clear crystal local oscillator design, a spectrum scope, dual receivers, and digital voice recorder. Don't forget about the IC7700 and the IC7600. Both of these top-of-the-line transceivers are still available and are sure to be the perfect companion for this contesting season. Visit www.icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM radios.
All right, we're back. And hey, again, guys, it's, Thanksgiving is here in just a couple days. Everybody have a great Thanksgiving out there. And we appreciate everybody that's joined us on the show tonight. And we really appreciate you being a part of our webcast. Help us spread the word. Help us bring some new people in here. And the show is here to help hams get questions answered and help new people. And share our experiences. Thanks a lot for those that called in and sent questions in. We really appreciate it.
Okay, well, thanks for inviting me, Tom, and appreciate everybody that called in.
All right, well, 73 to everybody. Thank you. Well, guys, I think we had a great show tonight. Believe it or not, I'm in North Carolina. Kathy and I are at our home in the Smoky Mountains over in western North Carolina in a little town or a little community called Tuckasegee. If you've never heard of Tuckasegee, look it up. The city's about the size of a pinhead on the map there. Anyway, if somebody will put in a Hangout link in the chat room, we'll try to join you in the Hangout. And I'm in the chat room also. So, 73s, we'll see you guys next week. And thanks a lot for showing up and joining the webcast tonight.